First, thank you, Claudio and Art Basel, for the invitation to moderate today's panel on collecting. And I would also like to thank our distinguished panelists, Jean Sherman in the center, Mr. Obayashi sitting next to her on the right, Shireen Khattar, and Lushan. Also like to thank all of you for making it out this morning on a Saturday and with rain, no less. Today we'll be talking about cross-cultural collecting in a period of growing nationalism in many countries, as well as easy mobility with collectors not only flying around the world, but also having many homes on different continents. Cross-cultural collecting may seem like a phenomenon in Asia that happens increasingly now, but in fact, the practice stretches back through many centuries. Here I'm thinking of transnational trade routes, which saw not only goods such as tea and spices traded, but also ideas, religion, values, as well as art and culture exchanged. The best known example, of course, is the Silk Road. And it's a growing trend among museums. For instance, here in Hong Kong with M+, which is collecting across Asia, as well as with Western art, such as the recent acquisition of Anthony Gormley's monumental installation, Asian Fields, and of course, homegrown art. Another example is the Qatar Museum Authority, which is also acquiring across the board in terms of geographies, genres, periods, and mediums, with a particular emphasis on Islamic and Arab modern and contemporary art. And at some of the larger Western-based institutions, such as the Guggenheim and the Tate, they are attempting to expand their curatorial perspective and programming, and by extension and to a degree, reshaping the art historical canon. This morning, we'll be discussing ideas of cross-cultural collecting and patronage. How does one go about collecting the unfamiliar? And how one might interpret local specificity and cultural differentiation to an outside or alien audience? It's a bit difficult to generalize what cross-cultural might be, but some of the more familiar examples include artists in residency programs, where a foreign artist is invited to do a residency in another country and to create a work based on his experience with locals there within a set period of time. Another is the biennial festival, and here I'm thinking of more of a city or country or regionally specific festival such as Gwangju, Taipei, Sharjah, Singapore. Oftentimes a foreign curator is invited to be the artistic director. And within a short period of time, some, but not all, attempt to grasp and engage with the local scene, the local culture, situation, the local artists, the museums, the market, as well as the social and the political issues, and weave all of those elements into the curatorial theme of their show. Somewhat more problematic are country or region-specific shows organized by international museums, typically in cities such as New York, London, or Paris. These are attempts to create authoritative surveys of another country or region's art scene, often by curators with very little knowledge of the place outside from names circulating in the marketplace. What I've mentioned are just a few obvious examples of cross-cultural institutional practices. But what shape could cross-cultural collecting take on an individual level? Today, we have four leading collectors who are engaged in cross-cultural collecting, and each will tell us about their own journeys of how they began extending their holdings beyond the familiar to include artists of all nationalities and disciplines. Proceeding in alphabetical order is Shireen Khattar, who is a founding member and executive director of Platform Projects in Singapore. It's a relatively new nonprofit that harnesses the energies of collectors and patrons in Singapore by offering a range of opportunities for them to support, such as curatorial and artist residencies, art research, site-specific commissions, as well as focused exhibitions. Shireen is a member of Tate's Asia-Pacific Acquisitions Committee and the National Gallery of Singapore's Acquisition Committee. She is also the founding partner of the Marmalade Group and the Big Idea, a holding company that owns and operates well-known food and beverage brands and concepts in Singapore. Lu Shun is the partner founder of the Sifang Art Museum, an exhibition space covering over 20,000 square feet, designed by the New York architect Stephen Hall in the eastern Chinese city of Nanjing, which was just unveiled last autumn. Shun studied nanotechnology at Cambridge University and became involved in the Sifang Culture Group in 2007, which was launched by his father, Lu Jun. The company invests in real estate, hotels, and cultural projects. He is also a member of Tate's Asia-Pacific Acquisitions Committee. Mr. Obayashi is one of the top collectors of Japanese and international art in Tokyo. He's also the fourth generation member of Obayashi, a major construction company in Japan, where he is presently the director and chairman of the company. Since 2008, he has been the honorary consul of the Republic of Lithuania, and in London, a member of the Japanese Committee of Honor at the Royal... You're Lithuanian. Honor at the Royal Academy of Arts and the Tate International Council Executive Committee. Dr. Jean Sherman in the center is the chairman and executive director of the Sherman Contemporary Art Foundation, a philanthropic organization dedicated to the public exhibition of Australian contemporary art from Australia, the Asia-Pacific region, and the Middle East. She is also adjunct professor at the College of Fine Arts in Sydney, the deputy chair of the National Portrait Gallery Board, and a committee member of the Tate Asia-Pacific Acquisitions Committee and the International Association of Art Critics. From 1986 to 2007, she was the director and proprietor of Sherman Galleries. So to begin this morning, I would like to ask each of you to describe your first encounter with an artwork not familiar to you. I mean, meaning outside of your own culture or city. What did you acquire it? And if so, what compelled you to acquire the work? How did you come to know about it? And did you do any preliminary research? Would you like to start?
Sure. Good morning. Good morning. I think I prefer the cross-cultural, yes, but I also prefer the more of a transient state between different cultures. The work I want to mention is by this Vietnamese artist, Yen Vo. The name of the work is called We the People. We later on managed to show that work in our opening exhibition in the main exhibition hall. Give you a little bit of background information. He was a Vietnam-born artist who with his father flee the country at the age of three and got picked up by a Netherlands cargo ship on the ocean and later on started to live in the West. So he, I think, is a great representation of what, from an artist's perspective, cross-cultural means. The work With the People, he rebuilt the Statue of Liberty, which is practically a modern time icon. And then he used the Chinese factory, a factory actually very near my home in Nanjing, to reproduce the Statue of Liberty one-to-one scale, but never as the whole statue. So all he did was that he asked the factory to cut the, to produce the Statue of Liberty in pieces, never as a whole, in pieces over the time of maybe 3 years, in a total of about 220 pieces. We managed to show the last 12 pieces of this work scattered in a very beautifully lit natural light exhibition space, each one kind of talking to each other, having a very distinctive form, and having a very interesting relationship to the mother figure, which is the Statue of Liberty, but in the end, they will never go back to form as a whole. This really reminds, you know, has a lot of relationship to my personal experience as well. I'm sure as his personal experience is that people of the same nationality scattered around the world, Their relationship with their mother country, maybe then they can never go back, or the interesting sensitivities between the parts and the whole. So these kind of things I quite enjoy, which is why we decided to show the work, and later on we managed to collect several pieces of this work. Yeah.
Thank you. Mr. Obayashi?
Okay. Hello, good morning. I've been familiar with the art for a long time because my father loved art. So I used to see an art magazine at home. But the first time I encountered the cross-cultural thing was probably when I was involved in a large-scale office commission art project for our headquarter building. We asked 18 artists to do the site-specific commission works. That was 1998 to 1999. I thought this is great because, you know, I could meet many artists from all over the world. They're all emerging artists at that time. Including David Tremlett, Peter Halley, Daniel Biran, Yayoi Kusama. They designed and made not only site-specific but sometimes functional artworks for meeting rooms or corridor or reception desk. Reception desk or So I thought this is great, you know, I can not only meet the artists, but also we can support these artists and also we can ask them to do something, we can work together. I didn't really think about the nationalities or different cultures, but they made wonderful works for our office. So for me, cross-cultural things mean something, but commission works are more, you know, interesting at that time. Mm.
Mm. And Jean, I mean, you came to Australia via South Africa, so it'd be interesting to hear.
Firstly, I want to find out, can everybody hear? I'm such a practical person, I couldn't bear not to ask that question. Look, I came from such a cross-cultural background that the whole idea of cross-culture was a part of my life. I thought everybody was cross-cultural, so it didn't ever occur to me that, in a way, monolingual people or people who had only ever experienced one culture were not part of my childhood or my world at all. In my own family, at least six languages were spoken. So, you know, there was a crossing of cultures right in my own space. But Asia, because I was born, as Elaine said, in South Africa, Asia felt very far away. The languages that were spoken and the cultures that were understood and engaged with tended to be European, Lithuania. I've just found out that Obayashi's son has got a link with Lithuania, Austrian Lithuania, on my mother and father's side. And that those were my grandparents. But Asia felt very far away from an African point of view, African/European point of view. And I can remember a very, very clear moment when I was, as Elaine mentioned, I had a commercial gallery from 1986 to 2007, and then the foundation, which started in 2008 and continues to this day, the not-for-profit foundation. I was sitting at my desk. It was an open plan space which we still own, but it's not used as a gallery anymore, in Paddington in Sydney. And three young Chinese men came up the stairs. It was quite a vertical sort of building, and my office was open plan, and there were some works around the walls, so people were encouraged to come up the stairs and, you know, look at what wasn't the main exhibition space, which was a smaller exhibition space with my desk in the middle. And I didn't get up every time people walked in because obviously, I would have never done any work if every time someone walked through the office, I leapt up off my desk. But for some reason, and it wasn't as if these were the first Asian visitors either, but for some reason, and I can't describe to you what, they were talking in Chinese, and I recognized that, I just did get up off my desk and I said to the three of them, does anybody speak English? And only the one said a little. And I just sensed they were artists. And I said, are you artists? Yes. I knew they wanted to show me work because that's what all artists want to do, or most of them, when they come into a commercial gallery. I said, are you living in Australia? No, they were living in mainland China. I said, look, I've got 5 minutes. I never do this. But just this once, if you've got work, would you like to show me? And they rushed downstairs. They left their bags at the sort of coat check downstairs and brought out some work and laid it on the floor. And that was the beginning of my cross-cultural connection with Asia, which has lasted to this day. And those three artists are all friends. One's called Guan Wei. I helped Guan Wei then together with a group of other people come into Australia as a treasure, national treasure, not national treasure, something about a treasure, where you bring people in on a visa that's, you know, not the regular visa. And Arsien, who goes back to China now and is making his way through all the ancient Chinese arts of porcelain and jade and so on. And Shoshan Liu, who was the one that spoke a little bit of English. So it's been a long journey, but it started in that very early, late 80s in Paddington in Sydney. And I have spent a lot of time exploring Asian culture since then.
Thank you. And Shireen, you have a similar background to Jean.
Yes, no, I was going to jump in on that one. I think, like Jean, I'm blinkered as far as cross-cultural definitions are concerned. You grow up somewhere like Singapore and your point of reference or your framework is multicultural. So when you talk about being drawn to a work that is from another culture, that wouldn't be the way that I look at artwork. I have a Western education, a Western history of art education, and I've always been drawn to questions of art which are related to aesthetics and the theory and philosophy of art, and that's how I naturally respond to an artwork. But having said that, though, in recent years, with Platform, the foundation or the charitable organization that we set up in Singapore, the idea behind it was that we were going to be funded by collectors to do projects and commissions with artists and institutions from around the world to engage in Singapore with artists and institutions in Singapore. And that is fundamentally cross-cultural. One of the more exciting projects that we do, and this touches in what Elaine was just talking about, is a residency project that we have at the Singapore Tyler Print Institute. We've invited, so far we've had two artists through this program. The first one was Hegyu Young from Korea. A very interesting artist who practices out of Berlin. And in her experience in Singapore, where she was challenged to basically practice on a more multidisciplinary platform with the printmaking, as well as creating unique works, she was drawn to the markets, the spices, the Indian cultural influences in Singapore's Little India, and created a very interesting body of work that was a departure from where her original standpoint was. That was interesting to us. And the second artist that we've invited, Sun Shun, a Chinese artist of great renown and incredible work. And what you see now in Encounters in Art Basel, where we have Jingbang, this fictional sort of nation of a state within a state, was a project that whose ideas were born out of this residency in Singapore. So those are two very exciting collaborative projects that were cross-cultural that I would say that, you know, I was very excited to be involved with.
Thank you. Jean, this question's for you. Given your curiosity about the world, if you were to buy something...
Yeah, it's similar to saying contractors. The hallway will be open in 30 minutes. Please remove all the empty crates by 11:45 and ensure your galleries are ready.
Should we respond to that as well?
Yes. Let's get going.
That's cross-cultural.
So, Jean, if you were to buy something foreign or unfamiliar, how would you, where would you start?
Well, you know, I want to narrow this down a bit and just from my perspective personally and talk about East and West. So because Asia was so unfamiliar to me and I encountered these three artists, I didn't do anything about the situation before. The work all looked very unfamiliar to me, and I thought it's really time. I'm living in Australia in a region that geographically is relatively close to Asia. I had lost my job as a teacher, a lecturer of French literature to university because Australia had become focused on Asia and the Asian cultures and literatures were being uplifted where the European side was being downgraded. Not downgraded in the sense of its importance, but just the student numbers were going towards the Asian studies. I decided I'd better research and start getting to know Asia a little. And the gallery started in 86. I made my first trip to Japan in 87 with two of my sculptors, one Akio Makigawa and the other an Iranian called Australian called Hossein Valamanesh. I made, since then, 46 trips to Japan. I met Obayashi-san on one of them and went to his wonderful offices where each floor was, you know, commissioned work, functional and other, by different artists. And I became, I fell in love with Japan, really. I'm a big reader. I read Japanese literature. I'm going to read anyway. I was going to read and I continue to read everywhere, anyway on a daily basis. But I made my goal to read Japanese literature, fiction, not theoretical books about Japan, literature. Every day when I read, I focused on only Japanese literature in translation, obviously, into English or French, which I read as well. And I became immersed in Japan. Then I moved on to China. I read Elaine's magazine when before it started, from cover to cover. I went to biennales and triennales, and I focused on Asia. You can't see everything in a biennale. Can't see everything in an art fair. So I just keep that focus all the time, Asia, the Middle East, Australia, via every methodology that one could think of. Later with the technologies, obviously the net was a great help, and built up the knowledge. Then did what Lu Shun said, started incorporating these people into shows that I was doing, then got to know them as friends, and now crossing over the whole...
Yeah, of contractors, please remove all the empty crates by 10.
It's like being in an airport.
Well, I have 10 years of
cross-cultural airport.
It's mm-hmm. like being in an airport. So just to finish off, so it was, for me, it's always about a long journey of learning, then incorporating it, because I had a gallery and now a foundation, into the programs that I am running, and also separately, completely separately, into our private collection.
Mm. So, Mr. Obayashi, just, you know, as Jean said, her collecting came out of a particular situation in the mid-80s. Could you describe the situation in Japan when you started collecting and how it's evolved or changed, I mean, in terms of the art scene?
You mean about my collection or generally speaking?
In Japan, what was it like when you started collecting?
Okay. So as I said, you know, my project for the commission once for my head office was very, very strong to me. So I had a chance to meet those artists, and then, you know, the galleries, you know, started sending me the invitation of their exhibitions. Then I started going to the galleries, and then you know, they send another invitation of other, you know, artists, sometimes Japanese, sometimes international artists. And also, I was very lucky, you know, it was just about the, you know, the start of the big movement of contemporary art in the world, in Japan. Those galleries, the first generation of the Japanese contemporary art, you know, at that time, Murakami Ono was still showing, you know, but not too expensive, honestly speaking. So I had a chance to see and witness the very beginning of the contemporary art scene right now. Also, other things. Being a member of International Council of MoMA was very big to me, because every time when I went to the council meeting, they asked me, "What do you collect? What do you collect, Mr. Obayashi?" Gee, you know, I have to collect something. So, when I start collecting, so what should do?
When was this? When you were at MoMA?
That was a little after 2000. No. That was actually before. That was before our head office project.
Yeah, it was before.
Right,
yes.
Right. Because the council members, you know, came to the opening of our new head office.
I see. Yes.
But you know, it's little that. But so before collecting contemporary, I used to collect the architecture drawings. Because my business was close to the construction, I had a chance to meet the architects. But collecting architecture drawings had some conflict between my business and the private collection, because, you know, when I asked the architects to give their drawings, you know, whether this is this belongs to the corporate one or private one. Mm-hmm. So, and also, you know, there are little market for the architecture drawings. So I decided not to do that. Maybe I should collect some contemporary art, right? And at that time, I encountered with, I joined the commission project for our head office. But, you know, that project was very international. You know, international artists, cross-culture. But I found that there are so many great collectors in the world who are collecting those American or European. Sorry.
This is not so easy.
Sorry.
Better.
Oops. You know, there are so many great collectors of international contemporary art. So maybe I should show them the Japanese contemporary art, because they want to
find good Japanese contemporary artists. They want to see their works. So that's how I studied my Japanese and also Asian artworks. So now half of my, maybe more than half of my collection is Asian, and the Japanese artworks are probably one third, you know, in total. As a Japanese, I feel, you know, I should recommend, or I should encourage them, and I should show those Japanese artworks or Asian artworks to international collectors. That's how I feel.
Mr. Obayashi and Jean, how important is meeting artists for you in the process of discovering and, by extension, commissioning or collecting their works? Do you consciously go out to meet artists?
Can I start?
Yeah, you start.
I'm deeply interested in commission works. So I have a now guest house to show my collection. I add commission work every year. Last 2 years ago, I asked Liu Fan to do some work, and this year I'm asking Tatsuo Miyajima to do the new work. Because I can work together with the artist, because I feel, you know, I'm supporting the artist, and because it's unique. So I love commission works, but you know, we can do that for everything. So I also come to the art fair to buy pieces. So it's a combination of the commission works and regular acquisition.
Should I use this or go to that?
I think it's fine. I think Mr. Wai actually had it a bit down.
Can you hear?
Yes. Yeah.
Look, in my case, we have to separate my two aspects or facets of my contemporary art life, if you like. On the one hand, there was my role as gallerist in a commercial world, and then it transformed into my role as director of a not-for-profit organization, always focused on Asia, the Middle East, and Australia. And on the other hand, and I separate the two because there's my professional life and then there's my personal life. And on the other side is my life as a collector with my husband. That's a kind of joint venture. And we never collect anything in the personal collection that we don't both feel equally or almost more or less comfortable with. We both have to feel absolutely enthusiastic about the work that goes into the personal collection. In the foundation, 95% of what we do is commissioned work, and that was the same idea as Obayashi-san, that it that was my idea, to give people a chance to do their dream work. I have a specific budget for each project, which is the same for each project. And it's always Asia, the same area. Two-thirds Asian artists, a third Australian in the foundation. And that budget is just for the project. Then there's another budget, obviously, for the staff and the operating costs of the foundation. And so the joy of working with the artists, and I echo everything that Mr. Obayashi has said, is really,
yeah,
for me, seems to happen to me. Let's wait for the journey. Is it deliberate?
It is.
So that's the commissioned work. 95% of what we do is commissioned. Our next upcoming show, two Taiwanese artists across two spaces are often partner with another institution, and there are two commissioned works and one existing work. The whole project is called Home. On the personal side, the personal collection, I separate that out by saying Sometimes we buy. Very rarely we commission. Sometimes we buy or acquire from something that we have commissioned, but not often. It's often work that is existing that we find in an art fair or in a gallery or in a studio or via a recommendation or at a biennale. So I tend to separate the two because I haven't got two professions. The contemporary art is my personal passion and my profession. So it's a little different.
Hmm. Do you separate as well, your personal and the museum's collection?
I like to say, people often ask me that question, but I wouldn't say they're separated. Of course, I'm collecting for the museum, for the institution, but I think because I'm the person behind the collection, so it will always be a personal collection. Mm. It will always be something that represent what my taste is, what I like.
Together with your father?
Yes, he's not that involved into contemporary. He's interested in ink and other things. But we talk about contemporary art. But it's something I want to mention is that also what Jing just said, very interesting, is that she deliberately studied Asia. Mm. But for me or for the new generation Chinese, actually a lot of us are educated in the West. Mm. So and we're very, very Chinese deep inside. So those two things kind of come natural to us. Mm. And the first object I collected was actually a Western art, Marlene Dumas, but it's on paper. But it's very Chinese, if you look at it.
She's a South African.
Yes, that's right, South African. In the South, yes, that's right. Talk about later. I was probably the first Chinese to collect Western contemporary. A lot of the Chinese collectors, that was like 5 years ago. I started collecting 5 years ago. But now you see much younger people than me. I'm very young, but there's much younger people who start collecting a lot of Western art. At the same time, they look at Chinese contemporary as well. So for me, the progress was I looked at Chinese contemporary first, but I didn't buy. I bought Western, and then I went back to look at Chinese. Mm. I felt that was interesting because I would look at Chinese contemporary on a much more global scale, and that gave me a reference to pinpoint what this work is. Mm.
Sorry, I was just going to jump in on that because I completely agree. I think there's something to be said about contextualizing our experience of contemporary Asian art. Maybe it's a generational thing as well, but I think that with many of my generation in Southeast Asia, we might come from families who've been collecting you know, Indian art because we're Indian, or Chinese art because we've come from a Chinese family. But as you sort of experience the world and you travel and work, and you know, everyone is a global nomad of sorts nowadays, you come back and you relook at the national or the geographical boundaries that surround certain types of art that with I think an added insight. And that has been a very sort of enjoyable process for me in my own learning and journey in terms of how I look at collecting art for myself. But on the broader level, like for example with the other collectors that we work with at Platform, what's really interesting are those intersection points of, you know, Asian artists, Southeast Asian artists, whether they're doing residencies or commissions in other parts of the world, or whether or not it's just a response to global issues. And I think that is another aspect of cross-cultural collecting that is fascinating. Because it's not simply about how collectors choose to collect, it's also about the type of works that artists produce as a response to cross-culture and you know, the impetus to collect.
Mm. Just going back to you in Singapore, I was wondering if you could talk about, because you work with collectors in Singapore, you know, a place that's not really a nation, but rather a city-state comprised of many different cultures, religions, ethnicities. What are collectors like in Singapore? And, you know, given that contemporary art is a relatively new phenomenon in Singapore, what's driving this interest in collecting contemporary?
I think that it's hugely resonant now. It's a growing collector base. It's an entirely mixed bag. Singapore, I use the term global nomads just now as well. I mean, we have some Singaporean collectors, but there are many, many new Singaporeans, there are many expatriates that have moved to Singapore in the last 3-5 years, who've come with either existing collections or with an interest in Western art. But now that they're in Asia, they're looking very seriously at in the region as well. Singapore,
the region
is
meaning
Southeast
Asia.
But actually, no, I think possibly even wider, because I think when you have when you reside in Singapore, I think you look at Asia, Greater Asia as well. And Singapore has an interesting proposition. And I think Hong Kong, you know, is commercially an incredible force in terms of sort of Asian art. But I think Singapore, in terms of its institutional framework with museums, an interest in research and documentation, I think that creates a different sort of energy for collecting art. And it might be it might be a longer view. I don't think anything is going to happen very quickly, but I think it's a it's an interesting growing collector base, and one which hopefully will be increasingly informed over the next 3 to 5 years. Things like the National Art Gallery, when it opens, that's developing a collection of modern and contemporary Southeast Asian art, which could be very, very significant if documentation is and archiving is done in the way that it needs to be done in a robust way. I think that could be a significant force for Southeast Asian art in Singapore as well. So, yeah.
And speaking about museums, you're the only one with a private museum on the panel. So when you mount exhibitions, you not only show your own work from your own collection, you also borrow works from others. Could you talk about what's come out of those exchanges?
I think I name it a museum, but I think we're practically doing the same thing after hearing what you guys have done in the past. Just a little bit of background information on the project. Back in 2003, my father started this project by commissioning architects, so 24 architects around the world, top architects at that time, to each one working on a specific piece of lot, a specific piece of land. Uniquely incorporating their practice to the local scenario and local situation. It's all within a big complex of natural ground. Museum is one of the buildings, and there's other things like conference centers, there's a hotel, there's artist residence houses, so all kinds of things for visitors to have a holistic and fun experience. So we're not like an institution where we do historical surveys or very important shows, but what I really want to do is to create something, a very interesting experience for people just to enjoy themselves and art not being too serious. And something that my age should be suitable to do is something very interesting and fun and likable. Sorry, what was the question?
No, the question is that your recent show, you not only showed your own collection.
Yes.
You borrowed works.
Yes, that's right.
And through that exchange, has any relationships come out of that? Because many private museums are only showing their own, for instance.
Oh, okay.
That there's actually an exchange with other institutions or other individuals.
Right, I think it's difficult to do a show with just your collection. Sometimes it can. Sometimes, probably in the future, I would do a show with none of the collection works, all borrowed or all commissioned works. Mm. And sometimes maybe I do a show with collection. So it's very flexible. It depends on what the curator wants, what makes sense, what makes the most sense for the show. So for our show, we worked because it's the opening exhibition. So we worked the idea to accommodate many of the pieces in the collection. And then there's other things that we felt that was interesting to the space, because it is a very unique space. So some of the things that in the collection are probably not suitable for that space, because when we bought, we were not thinking about where to put, what spaces can house those. So then we commissioned artists to do specific works to accommodate that space, as well as borrow some works to accommodate that space. Mm-hmm. So for example, we did this beautiful garden right outside our museum, because the museum is in a natural compound. So we felt something very interesting to do was to commission an artist to do a garden for them to for the people to rest, take a nap or just chat, when they're not looking at very serious artworks. This garden was commissioned by conceptual Chinese artist Xu Zhen, one of I think his strongest works. It's called Movement Field. I don't have a picture, but something I really enjoyed is my favorite work of the open exhibition. Mm.
Jean, to what degree does the social context of where you're from, I mean, in this case, Australia, play into your collecting or philanthropic endeavors?
To what extent does Australia count, yes. in a way? Well, there are a couple of Australians in the audience. I don't see many, or many that I recognize. But Australia, apart from the Aboriginal indigenous population, is made up, like America is or was, of people from all over the world. So if you are trying to describe an Australian, and here we are in the cross-cultural, globalized world again, who do we mean? The original Australians, aside from the tens of thousands of years of Aboriginal presence in the country, the original Australians were Anglo-Celtic. So they came from England. We all know the story of the convicts and so on in 1788. But after the Second World War in 1945, there were waves of migrants from Southern Europe, from Italy and Greece, to a large extent. There were Holocaust survivors from Europe. And more recently, once that ghastly White Australia policy was dismantled in around 1970, I think it was 65, somewhere around there. I may have does anybody here know exactly when it was dismantled? Anyway, it was around 65. The Asian migration to Australia became quite dramatic. And I think, and I'm pretty sure I'm right, the population of Australia now, 23 million people, comprise about 10 to 12% Asians, naturalized Australians. I'm not talking about people with working visas or long-term residency visas, but people who call themselves Australian. So, when I was in the commercial gallery, I represented 27 artists on a regular basis, a third of whom were Asian Australians. Then I brought in three artists a year. I had two spaces, and they were all Asia-based Asians. Now I'm in the foundation. I'm doing 3 to 4 projects a year, and two-thirds of those projects are by Asian artists, and a third are by Australian artists. But the Australian artists could be Asian, or they could be coming from anywhere. So it's a difficult question, because are we talking about people with Australian passports? If so, they really come from every single part of the world. Mm. But like Mr. Obayashi, I do feel strongly about promoting and encouraging the artists who are in Australia. They have been disadvantaged by the tyranny of distance, which is a phrase that was developed by an Australian historian. And it's still, to an extent, I think, current. People come to Hong Kong. I'm leaving tonight. It's a seven-hour flight. I'm on the same time frame as you are. And yet people say, oh, I can't go to Australia. It's so far. Well, it is far. But it's actually not that much further, and it's not a different time frame. You know, it's 2 hours, that's all. And so those artists living in Australia, at least until Lu Xun's generation and our generation of high technology, sophisticated people, suffered from the tyranny of distance. So I wanted to, and I still want to, make sure that those artists, some of whom are just wonderful, whatever background they come from, but that are known as Australian, I want to make sure that their voices are heard, their images are seen. And I try as hard as I can on, say, for example, the Tate Asian Acquisitions Committee that we're all on, to say, don't forget Australia. Don't forget these Australian artists. You may not have seen as much of them as you might have seen of some of the Indian or Southeast Asian or certainly the Chinese artists, but they're there. And some of them might be Chinese or might be Indian or might come from Vietnam or Cambodia or anywhere else. Mm. So it's a bit of a fraught question in Australia in a way. Isn't
but
it,
also
Elaine?
A bit, could you talk a bit about the government, the governmental policy about shifting their perspective from, let's say, Europe
yes.
to Asia?
Well, it's, I mean, you know.
And how that has influenced your own program.
As we all know, politics is changes from a, you know, one government to the next. So in Australia, we arrived from South Africa via London in 1976. It's a long time ago now. And there have been varying governments, Labour governments, more socially inclined governments, social justice type governments, and more conservative governments. And each government has its own vision of what to do and what to do about Asia. The conservative governments think of Asia. This is my personal opinion, so please don't take it as the voice of Australia. My personal opinion is that the conservative governments think about Asia in terms of trade. How can we best engage with Asia so as to enhance trade and benefit financially and make the most of our very resource-rich country in our region? But the Labour governments, which are the more socially engaged governments, think about Asia, and that's how I think about Asia, in terms of, you know, an immense kind of mine, of not a diamond mine, gold mine, but a cultural mine of information, deep, rich cultures, all, you know, most of whom are sort of encapsulated in Singapore, aren't they? In a way, Shireen, because, you know, it's one little place with so many cultures rubbing shoulders. So I'm an Asian literary ambassador for Australia. I belong to a small group of Australian people from different business people and various, you know, professions. And what we do in schools and in universities and in forums is we say to Australians, become Asia literate. Whether you do it because you want to get rich or improve your job prospects, or whether you do it because you want to have the most fabulously interesting journey in life, do it. It's important. Hmm.
How does this differ to what's going on in China, Sean? I mean, there seems to be a kind of cultural policy happening in China right now in terms of a big push to arts, museums, that sort of thing.
Yeah, I'm not very too sure about that, because what happens up there is, I feel, is still quite different and far, far away from what we're doing as private patrons. A lot of museums are being built. You all know the numbers. I think there's about 2,000 museums being built in the past 5 years and the next 5 years. There's always the question
2,000.
Of
2,000.
Maybe more.
Maybe more.
Past maybe five more, years. Yeah. In the next 5 years. So, yeah, sorry.
And most of those museums are focused on?
They're focused on different things. So not just contemporary art.
Right.
Sometimes craftsmanship, antiques, all kinds of things. But the real question is, do you really have that many artworks to be housed in those museums? Mm. But it's something that China has been doing, you know, and is used to do this kind of way. I'm quite optimistic because it's always the hardware first, and then forced to think about the software.
I was just going to ask you, what's the biggest challenge as a founder of a cultural organization?
Oh, it's always the software.
Yes.
Yeah. The hardware is very simple. You just hire an architect, hire a contractor, finish the building. And what do you really do with this building, right? And this building is going to be there for a long time.
And do you have curators?
Oh, for me?
Yes.
Yeah.
And do you attract them from abroad, or are they coming from within China?
I like to keep a very open, free-thinking platform. So I'm thinking to ask, invite guest curators, and sometimes you know the idea comes from me, or the idea comes from other people. But I feel that having one curator sitting on, you know, could limit the scope of things that we would like to do, because everyone has their interest and focus. So I want to invite different curators for different things and different ideas that we want to explore. Mm. Yeah.
Mr. Obayashi, I wanted to ask you why you emphasize emerging Japanese and with the Western more blue chip. So, for instance, you want to support emerging artists from Japan, but when you look at Western, you've told me you've looked strictly at blue chip.
Well, I try to support emerging Japanese artists, but I also acquired international artist works. When I acquire international artist works, I really don't care, you know, whether they are emerging or established. I care about budget, of course, like everybody else. But I would say I buy whatever I want for the international artist, but I try to focus on emerging artists for Japanese artists, because international museums have collected Japanese established artists' works already. So you can go to museums, in New York or in Europe, and you can see Murakami's works and Nara's works, Sugimoto's work. I do have some Sugimoto's works, but just because he's a good friend of mine. So I emphasize, I try to find and encourage more emerging Japanese ones.
Mm. Yeah.
I think it's a bit similar to me situation in China, because I look at Western artists most of the time after some time already, because I don't live in the West. Okay, it's very important for you to live in the same situation with a bunch of artists, and therefore I look at Chinese emerging artists because I live with them, and I will be the first to find out about them, to know about them, and to support their work. Mm-hmm. It really is. It sometimes as simple as that. It's the proximity. And for the Western artists, sometimes I find out most of the time after many others have found out. Mm. So, by at a later stage, yeah.
It's also related to about the visitors to my private guest house. I have a guest house to show my collection in Tokyo, and have made about this public in Japan, but I have received many interviews from international magazines and TV. So international collectors know about my space, but it's not really open to public, so I accept visitors only by appointment. So I have actually more visitors from foreign countries than Japan.
Yeah.
And as a matter of fact, you know, the trustee members of the Asian Society came to my house and in the evening of 15th, so I couldn't leave Japan till the, yesterday morning. So like that, you know, fortunately, there are many international visitors, collectors to my guest house.
Why do you think Japanese don't come?
And, well, there aren't so many collectors who open up their houses, spaces, private spaces to the guests. So they want to see the private spaces. Actually, I don't live there, so it's not really a private space, but still, you know, it's not open to the public, so it's a semi-private space. So I want to show emerging Japanese artist works to those visitors. That's why I always have some, you know, those Japanese artist works with established or some well-known international artist.
Shreen, and you know, what led you to launch platform projects? I mean, did you have Singaporean artists in mind when you launched this organization?
Actually, no. Obviously, we wanted to do something that would enrich the contemporary art landscape in Singapore. We wanted to work with Singaporean artists, but it wasn't primarily only about Singaporean artists practicing art in Singapore. It was about creating a dialogue, a conversation between Singaporean artists and the rest of the world, because the museums and there are other non-profits, there are other research centers that are focused on Singaporean art and Singaporean artists, but we wanted to fill the gaps of where perhaps other institutions or other nonprofits were not actually sort of engaged in. And for me, it's that conversation between Singapore and the rest of the world that I think is going to enrich the practice of Singaporean artists. We're very new. The art landscape there is you know, this is an exciting time, but it's early days. And for example, one of the projects that we're doing is a mentorship series. It's going to be a series of public commissions which result in public works. But the idea is that the works will be produced by Singaporean artists, but we are creating a mentorship for the Singaporean artists. We're taking a Singaporean artist to a residency somewhere else, or we're bringing an international artist to Singapore to mentor the Singaporean artist, resulting in a public sculpture. Because things like substantial public sculpture is, an area that needs to be discussed. It needs to be brought to the forefront. It's not simply, we wish it, we draw it, it will be done. There's conservation, there's all kinds of issues that are new to Singaporean artists. These are big things to grapple with, the architectural side. You know, it's those kind of experiences, conversations, and basically collaborative platforms that we're trying to build. Ultimately, yes, we want to, it's with Singaporean artists in mind as well, but in a way that is positions it on a global platform. And that's how we look at it.
I don't think there's going to be another overhead announcement because I think, oh no, the fair is going to open soon, but would anybody like to ask our panelists any questions? Yes, I think there's a mic coming. And if you could say your name.
Hi, thank you very much. My name is Marion, and I'm a French journalist living in Singapore. And I have a question for Lu Sun. And being so young and already having enough materials, a big collection to to have a museum. Can you come back a little bit to the origin of this collection, how it all started? And my second question would be, we talk a lot about cross-culture, but I'd be interested to understand the cross-generation in terms of collecting in China between your parents' generation and the new generation that you belong to. Thanks.
Sure. I think in China it's always strange as to how it started and how it progressed. For us, also we built the museum first, thinking that's something that we're interested to do. But at the time when we built it, very naive, didn't know anything about contemporary art, didn't know what we were getting ourselves into. The first, when we first bought contemporary art, because my father, he's not interested in contemporary art. He's extremely interested in Chinese inca. He's a big collector in historical artifacts and documents and archives of the Republican times, one of the most important collections in China. So he's interested more in the history part of things, the documents part of things. But when we first bought contemporary art, it was, I'll be very honest, that it was from the point of investment. Okay? But it turns out that everything failed when you think about art from an investment point of view. Became a bunch of junk. So I got involved in 2008 thinking that it should be done another way. Already the museum was in construction, so I began to morph the ideas in regards to what was already existing. What I should do with this existing site of a lot of architectural gems and interesting landscape, natural surroundings. It's a destination, not in the city center of Nanjing. As well, Nanjing is not the two art centers or two or three art centers of China, Chengdu, Shanghai, and Beijing. Nanjing is quite out of nowhere, right? Very strong in traditional art. Classic art, but never in contemporary art. So, therefore, what will be the position of me to work with this existing compound and make it interesting? Also, how do you formulate the collection to speak to that environment, to that existing condition? So that is the task I had in mind, and which is what I've been working on for the past 4 or 5 years. You talked about the cross-generation collection. I think it's extremely interesting in China because things happen so fast. And my father's generation, they probably not looking at contemporary art at all. Or even if they buy, it's from another perspective. But you see more and more people of my age, passionate, extremely passionate about contemporary art. And really understanding it because of the way we were raised, because cross-cultural, we are cross-cultural human beings, and artists as well. If you look at Chinese artists possibly born after 1950s, between 1950s and 1970s, they're very distinctive. Okay, the ones whom we're very familiar with, Zha Xiaogang, Yue Mingqing, these people form a very distinctive group. And then you look at people, because they've been through the roughest times of China, right? And then they got really rich when they were, you know, 40 years old. And, you know, things happened very quickly and really affected some of them. Then you have the Chinese artists who were born after 1970s, whom they were kind of at this interlink between the older artists. And they experienced all the culture, you know, all the chaotic China, and then they've also experienced the modern China, the really contemporary China. So they possess a very unique sensibility in their art, you know, like Liu Wei, Xu Zhen, all these people. And then you've got the artists in after 1980s, people like us, whom I'm very interested in, whom probably went to study abroad or started to absorb lots of Western knowledge, not Western culture, when they were in high school, for example, in 15 years or 16 years old. They are very unique as well, okay? And then you look at artists now, there's changes very quickly. Then you look at artists who were born after 1990s, extremely young artists. I see some of these young artists at the fair already, and they're selling quite well because people are always digging for young artists. You look at them, when they were born, they were just immersed in this modern, contemporary, Western Chinese, all kinds of things environment. So what they do is crazy. They try all kinds of crazy things. It's very interesting.
Among your friends, just to follow up, among your friends of your generation, are you an exception, or I mean, are your friends that want to collect art? Do they have money? Do they want to collect blue chip, Western blue chip, or Chinese blue chip? But you, with your orientation to emerging Chinese, are you an exception, or is that really the trend among young collectors?
Well, certainly there's quite a handful of people like me who are genuinely passionate about. But there's also people who, because I think we learn very quickly. So we've all been through the stage of not knowing too much about art and buy blue chip only. Okay, and everyone starts somewhere, right? And then you buy blue chip, you see, and then you're looking at, oh, I'm having the same thing as many other people in the world. How do I make myself unique? How do I make myself interesting? How do I make the collection interesting? I think everyone kind of just follows that route now, but it just takes time. So in about 10 years, if you look back, there's going to be a lot of interesting collections in China whom they all went through the blue chip, and then they the budget maybe is not there anymore, or different things. Maybe they want to do interesting things, look at interesting artists, look at emerging artists, supporting emerging artists, buy more conceptual stuff. You know, it's a natural progression. And people are following different progress and different rate. So it's very interesting to see, but happened very quickly in China. Yeah.
Question there, back, the woman.
Thank you. My name is Teresa Rodriguez. I represent Montclair State University, George Siegel Gallery. My question is directed to all of the panelists. And this has to do with national identity, which is actually a problem currently being challenged to Southeast Asian countries. And the trend being a focus, an internal focus, versus global art, which is an external direction towards art. How do you address that in your collecting policies or practice?
Can I jump in that to start off with? I think it's interesting because it's one of the things that, for example, at the National Gallery in Singapore, it's key to have that focus on the national art, on identity. And I think identity is particularly something that is constantly grappled with in Southeast Asia and these new economies, these new sort of geopolitical sort of states as well. But I think for Singapore, what's interesting is that you're looking at Singapore as in terms of its artistic identity, but there is a great awareness of the interplay between the rest of Southeast Asia and Singapore as well. So there is a sense of possibly even responsibility in terms of archiving and documenting what is happening in the other Southeast Asian states as well. So in terms of actually sort of, so when you look at the identity of the, looking at the national identity of Singapore through its art, its modern and contemporary art, I think you will always, in Singapore anyway, I think that we will see the relationships being explored further between the Southeast Asian sort of neighboring countries as well, and also a certain amount of focus to actually sort of document, archive, and collect the works of Southeast Asian artists as well, if because that's from the Singaporean perspective.
I'd like to answer that in a broader kind of way. I know that you're talking about interior and exterior, but broader, what I mean by broader, I mean referring to literature or to film or to the visual arts, or perhaps to an extent less so to architecture. I think this is the local global question that in a way you're asking. I think that, if I understand it correctly, yes, I think that art, good contemporary art, needs to reflect the times in which the artist is living. You know, it's no good us going back to the bronzes of the 19th century, however technically good a 21st century artist is, if it doesn't reflect in some way the present time. So that's the first thing. But then the second thing is the good art, whether it's, you know, we're talking contemporary, so good contemporary art, film, fashion, literature, reflects something of the inner world of the creator. So it's that local, that interior-exterior kind of balance in a way that creates a work that transcends, that's part of its culture and transcends its culture. And that's when a work becomes important. So if it doesn't have anything of its culture embedded in it, or anything of the person that has created it embedded in it, how can it possibly speak to anybody, really? But of course, a lot of people have, you know, very, I suppose, significant inner lives. We all have significant inner lives. We're all significant. But at the same time, not all of us can externalize those lives via a creative medium and externalize those lives sufficiently so it resonates with people outside. And that's really what makes an artist, whether you're talking about a writer and so on. It's a fine balance, and it's a difficult thing to achieve. Well, that resonated.
Any other questions? Well, I thought maybe to conclude that...
I am a gallerist from São Paulo, Brazil. I've been to the fair in the last 4 years. And when you imagine, and when we were saying about Western art, it's usually we're thinking much more about America and Europe, and especially the Western Europe. A question is like, how do you see this connection that could exist now between all those emerging and new situations happening and gaining evidence and attention all over the world? So you have Latin America, we have Eastern Europe, we have Middle East. So how those connections may happen, and if you're looking at those other markets or scenes, and also how do you think the fair is playing a role or could play a role putting more universes together and creating more plurality, and if this is interesting for a collection or for your research?
Can I? This is not acquisition, but I am leading an artist residency program in Japan. We invite two artists every year from foreign countries and one curator from other countries. Always we try to invite artists from emerging countries, including Southern America, like Erika Berzutti of Brazil, or Indonesian artists or some other. Because you know, we could have sent Japanese artists to other countries to do something, to experience the cross culture. But I thought, you know, we should probably invite, you know, those artists from other countries, and because then we other members can experience, you know, watching or having fun together with those artists. And then if they had good experience in Japan, after they go back to the countries and after they become famous and you know, have exhibition at other countries, they can talk about the good days in Japan. So without, you know, it's, they are good ambassadors, cultural ambassadors. So that's why we support those artists and you know, we both can learn a lot. And I, every time they spend 3 months in Japan and make something and have small exhibition, I buy a part of the works every year.
Would anybody else like to answer this gentleman's question?
I think it's really interesting. I think for contemporary art, it's always about the situation, like Jing said, the situation or the living condition or the country or the culture, or mostly
the
culture, exactly, the proximity,
about,
yeah. The culture that's behind the art. So it's really, really interesting for the different cultural regions right now, emerging or not, to have a strong diversity of interesting works, interesting body of works that are speaking to its mother culture. Personally, I'm extremely interested in Latin America, Eastern Europe, Middle East. Just haven't got time to research. We need a lot more time, yeah. Yeah.
I'll just add one little word there. And again, it comes back to what I said earlier, and that is we have a residency program as well. It's called SFA. It's across the road from the gallery. And we have filmmakers, writers, animal activists, part of my family, Animal Protection Philanthropic Foundation. My son's a film producer. We have scholars, we have academics, and they can come from anywhere. We don't advertise it, and I don't like them to stay longer than 2 weeks because I don't want to run a holiday house. It's not a it's not a working space. It's an apartment, or it's really a little house, but there's a huge amount of cross-cultural interest. They've always come for a project, but maybe a project nothing to do with us. So, you know, there are many ways of including people from all over the world. And that's one of the ways in which I step out of Asia and into other parts of the world, from Poland, wherever.
Yeah, we are all involved in the Tate activities. But
yes, actually this panel is about the Tate acquisition. Yes. It's not about cross-cultural collecting.
But Tate has a Latin America acquisition committee, and they put some money and they buy good works of good artists and give it to the Tate Museum. So
And there's Art Basel Miami, you know, which really is very close, as you know, probably better than we do. So there are many ways via which these perhaps earlier neglected parts of the world have been, to an extent, incorporated.
I think the Middle East is also a very interesting area, because in terms of the, you know, the numbers, some of the very interesting art fairs that have emerged out of the Middle East in recent years. Dubai, I find, you know, a fantastic experience. I see things in Art Dubai that I wouldn't see in any other fair. Mm-hmm. So that's very interesting. And in Singapore, there's going to be a fair at the end of the year, I think in November, which will also have a focus on Middle Eastern art. I mean, that's cross-cultural.
Me too.
Yes, the Manassa Art Fair. So I believe that we have two more minutes. Any other questions? Otherwise, I highly encourage all of you to go and visit each of the organizations, their museums, their private tea house, Jean's foundation in Sydney, and whatever projects that platform projects is supporting.
Please.
They're doing important work, and it will give you a glimpse as to what's happening in their local scenes. Yes, of course. And actually, I said they're museums. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
You must go.
We all want to go.
The Tate's going.
Yes. Can we each have our own private villa? Okay. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you.